Hello and welcome to this budget special episode of Wealth Manager. All eyes are on the much awaited union budget, which is just round the corner. Continuing with our budget series, today we'll talk about what you can expect on the personal taxation front. Will budget 2015 leave you with more money in your hands? Joining me is a panel of experts who will tell us what to expect from the finance minister this time round. Kuldeep Kumar, leader personal tax, PwC, Parizad Sarwala, partner at KPMG, and Pallavi Bakru, director, Grant Thornton. Thank you all of you very much for joining me on the show. Kuldeep, let me come to you first. Before getting into the specifics, how much emphasis do you expect the FM to give to individual tax payers this time round, especially post the Delhi elections?
Yeah, you very rightly asked that, actually. I mean, a few weeks back, if you had asked this question from me, and my view was that, we will see this budget more to be on the policy front, or there will be structural changes. So having given the, raised the basic exemption limit by 50,000 last year, and also increasing the limit for ATC, deduction or deduction for the housing loan by 50,000 rupees. So, a good amount of, swaps were given last year. So keeping this in mind and the fact that, the government focus is on the growth, and the government really wants to revive the manufacturing, which will generate, more employment opportunities and also push the growth. So the focus is going to be more on the corporate tax side of the thing. But of course, having, lost the Delhi election and the general sentiment, what we are seeing around the land bill. So I think there may be some populist, this budget may also be a little bit of a populist, although the changes or the benefit which he may be extending may not be that much actually, which we will see in this budget from a personal tax point of view.
Parizad, coming to you, taking Kuldeep's point forward, given that there was already a hike in personal tax exemption limits last time, how likely is a rejig again this time, and to what extent, if at all?
Yes, so I was just reading some of the reports which said that a survey conducted across 11 cities in India seems to be indicating an absolute, urge on the part of the common man to further see a hike in these rates. Now, as Kuldeep mentioned, last year itself, there was a tweaking of 50,000 rupees in the starting slab. I do feel that, while the chances are definitely there to further tweak it maybe a little bit more. But however, if you ask my personal aspirations, if you compare some of these rates and stack it up with some of the advanced countries of the world, while we have a very good top tax rate of 30%, it triggers at a very low threshold, which is, very low compared to some of the countries of the West. So if one were to really look at giving and translating some savings into all kinds of taxpayers, there is a case actually to hike the maximum amount of threshold not chargeable to tax. As it was mentioned earlier, there may be a wee bit of chance that it is populist this time, because you also have to look at the tightrope balancing of managing the fiscal deficit of 3.6%. I'm just optimistic of a slight tweaking here and there, not major changes in this slab rate.
Pallavi, coming to you, as far as the housing loans are concerned, what are you expecting on that front? Anything on the interest exemption limits?
So I think that's again something that was revised last year. One could argue that there is no case to really look at revising it all over again this year. But again, clearly, the sentiment being that one, the government definitely wants to push housing. I think real estate is a sector which could do with, more traction, and probably making it more attractive for people to buy houses seems the right way to go. And, from a tax perspective aside, if you just start looking at the limits, I mean, a 2 lakh rupee limit just doesn't seem realistic in today's times. When you look at the average cost of buying a dwelling unit, and forget the metros, even the tier 2 cities, it just doesn't seem realistic enough to really incentivize people to either buy a house, or, like I said, the real sort of challenge here being to give a boost to the real estate industry. So I think there is a very real case in terms of just making those numbers more sensible and in line with what the market really holds.
Right. So, Parizad, as far as the HNIs are concerned, there are two aspects. One is the wealth tax and the other is the surcharge. So let's come to the wealth tax part first. It's a base of 30 lakhs currently. Some are expecting it to be increased to 50 lakhs. Others expect it to be increased to 1 crore. But whatever the increase, this is something that is expected to be announced?
I really don't think so at this stage, because this limit itself of 30 lakhs was changed from 15 in the recent past. Also, one needs to take a look at the wealth tax provisions. Currently, there are only 6 unproductive assets which are really subject to wealth tax, and a large part of the financial assets are outside the purview of the wealth tax. While there may be a case to further look at increasing the exemption limit of 30 lakhs a little higher, I personally don't see that happening because this limit itself was raised, I think, around 2-3 years back itself.
Okay. Kuldeep, what about you? Do you agree with that?
You know, the wealth tax, the collection has been very little. I think 950 crore. So I think on the wealth tax, it is more of the compliance issue. I mean, the government really need to enforce that. I mean, how people actually voluntarily come forward and pay. And 30 lakh limit is a ridiculous, you know, even if you are having more than one house, which actually gets subject to the wealth tax. So the 30 lakh is a very low limit. So I think that on the wealth tax side, there needs to be, you know, more of the compliance which the government need to enforce. So I feel you will see a lot of things actually, you know, which will come as a token, which will cheer you, but be ready also to offer some money, particularly the higher income group, towards the various scheme of the government.
Pallavi, now I have to ask you as a tiebreaker, which side do you fall on? Do you believe that there will be a tinkering with the wealth tax this time around?
See, I think Kuldeep has a very valid point when he says the 30 lakh threshold, doesn't really make sense in today's times. But my sense is that probably nothing will be done to wealth tax. You know, any budget is a balancing act. And I think the government has more than its fair share of balancing to do with this one. My sense is that, and where I completely concur with Kuldeep, is that, yes, there will probably be a greater desire to enforce compliance. Wealth tax has been one area where compliance has not very rigidly been followed up. Most people don't file their wealth tax return either out of ignorance or because of the fact that, you know, there hasn't been a push from the government to make sure that people do. And that could be another source of revenue. I don't see it as being a very large source of revenue, but yes, it definitely could be an alternative source of revenue.
All right. So Kuldeep, coming to section 80C, it's a section which is crowded with several options. As a result, whether it's the mutual fund or the insurance industry, they all really want a piece of the 80C pie exclusively for them. How do you believe that the FM will deal with this? Will he increase the overall limit and let the investor decide, or will he go with dedicating a separate limit for each of these?
See, the various items which are included for, deduction under Section 80C, you know, there are such a large list of the items. And, we see the taxpayer actually planning their investment in such a manner they have to save minimum under Section 80C, but at the same time, they want to utilize the maximum benefit of under Section 80C. So while the limit was raised to 150,000, so, you know, I'm not sure, but I mean, he may increase the limit to 50,000. But I believe that rather than touching, Section 80C, rather he may, you know, think of, for example, Section 80CCF, you know, which was there until a couple of years back, that if you invest in infrastructure bonds, then you get a deduction up to 20,000 rupees.
So, Pariza, do you expect the limit on the infrastructure investment limit to be reintroduced again this time round?
Yeah, so I mean, if you see the absolute, thrust on infrastructure and augmenting funds in that sector, there is definitely a case to introduce the 80CCF bonds again, even if the limit is restored to 20,000, what it was a few years back. That should be at least a good start, because if you see, in any case, there are hardly any exemptions or deductions available under the law. I mean, we just spoke on the crowded limit of 80C. So for salaried taxpayers also, this was a good way to channelize a certain amount of savings and, you know, increase the net disposable. Plus, it also marries with the government's objective and the agenda of infrastructure.
Right. So, Pariza, sticking with the long-term investment requirements, the retirement savings is something that also needs a whole lot of push in India. Yeah. And there is a need to create a separate tax incentive for that, which even the various industries are pushing for. Do you think we can expect something like this, since not only is it going to help long-term funds really come in, it will also not have any material change in the tax outgo, so to speak?
Yeah, so, you know, there is definitely a need to look at retirement products in a much more focused manner. And very often people don't really think long term as far as an Indian mindset is also concerned. There has been a huge amount of, lobbying from the mutual fund industry to have certain pension plans as a separate, carve out for tax deductions. just the way you would have the NPS, which was started a few years back, but it didn't really pick up in the way the regulator intended it to be. Because at the end of the day, one must understand that what do I get as an individual taxpayer if everything is going to be carved out of this 150,000 laundry list, which we just spoke about? It doesn't really make much of an economic or a tax sense from any individual taxpayer's perspective. So I'm not too sure whether, a separate deduction is going to be allowed for these pension plans. There is definitely a need to. And at least even as far as if we want to really popularize the NPS scheme, then it should be completely, while you have the Section 80 CCD, it's part of the ATC limit of 1,50,000. So that's not making any sense. And there is definitely a lot of mutual fund players are lobbying for getting these pension plans the way you have the ELSS scheme. But if it comes, then it has to be definitely as a separate tax deduction. But I'm personally not too optimistic about the same being introduced in this budget.
Time for a short break. We'll continue this conversation when we return. Welcome back. You're watching Wealth Manager, and I'm in conversation with Kuldeep Kumar of PwC, Parizat Sarwala of KPMG, and Pallavi Bakru of Grant Thornton. Pallavi, do you expect that the tax exemption limits for allowances like education, transport, medical, we know that they've not been revised for almost 17 years or so. And with the increasing costs, most expect some increases here. But at the same time, there's also this expectation that he will revive the standard deduction, which was also removed in 2005-06. And so instead of tinkering with different exemptions, do you think we could simply see the standard deduction really come back in to offset the other smaller exemptions?
I'd be quite inclined to kind of wager a bet that, he's more likely to do something like that. Either they would tinker with the, basic exemption limit, or maybe bring back the standard deduction. Like you said, it used to be there that you could get a standard deduction of 20% of your salary or 1,00,000 rupees, whichever is lower. I completely agree with you that, the limits for, whether it's education allowance, 100 rupees per child, per month, up to a maximum of 2 children sounds so ridiculous in today's times. It's the same for transportation, 800 rupees a month. There's a lot that can be done in terms of rationalizing a lot of these limits. And, we can also talk about things like, the medical expenditure reimbursement limit of 15,000. It's sort of, completely unrealistic in today's times by way of being a quantum that really gives relief to anybody. But my sense is, we could have a long wish list of, everything that could possibly, be sanitized and maybe sort of made more in line with, what the cost of living today is. But I think it's going to be an either or. And my sense is that, they'll probably go with either the tinkering of the slab rates. Now, if you recall, there was a standing committee for the direct tax code that had been set up, which had looked at the slab rates and recommended a basic exemption limit of 3 lakhs and looking at a graded limit where 20 lakhs becomes the uppermost limit for taxation beyond 30%. If you just quickly do the math, I did some quick numbers before getting on to this conversation with you. If somebody is earning 50 lakhs a month per annum, you see their tax computation under the current tax rates, and you look at what they'll get if we, take the basic exemption limit up to 3 lakhs and, go under the slightly liberalized slab rates for where the maximum rate kicks in only after 20 lakhs. We're talking about a relief of about 1,55,000 rupees. And really, from my perspective, I think that kind of a change would make far more impact than, tinkering with little limits of taking something from 800 rupees to 2,000 rupees or from 100 rupees to 500 rupees a month, really.
Parizat, moving to the mutual fund industry, any chance that you believe that the FM would tinker with Section 54EC to save long-term capital gains post-property sale? SEBI has also been pushing for this proposal that mutual funds be re-allowed under this section. Do you think this could really come through?
So 54EC is basically a rollover relief if you, sell any other asset which is long-term and you invest it. Currently, there are only certain debt products like bonds of REC, NHAI and all which are allowed up to particular thresholds. Again, as I said, there is a lot of, representation from the mutual fund industry to say that this should also cover investments in mutual fund products. But, as has been discussed right throughout this conversation, how many, with emphasis also being on the finance minister taking care of larger corporate tax and other larger tax issues which have been looming around the horizon, I do not expect too much of changes in the personal tax regime. So personally, I don't think 54EC is going to be changed or done anything with it at this moment in this budget. But that's my view.
Right. Kuldeep, you had also spoken about the tax structure for ESOPs that need to be changed from the current double hit that the employees face to a single point taxation.
ESOP schemes need to be more tax efficient. Currently, how ESOPs are taxed is that at the time of allotment, the employee has to pay the tax on the market value of the share less the price which he has paid to acquire those shares. And when he actually sells those shares, then he pays the capital gain tax, depending upon whether it's a long-term or short-term. So, at the time of allotment, when the shares are allotted, the employee may actually not be having to pay the tax, and he has to either sell the shares or he has to pay the tax. And later on, suppose the price of the share actually come down, then, he actually incurs a loss on the sale of the shares. And then he does not get any benefit of the tax outgo, which he has already paid at the time of allotment. So I think with the scheme, the one-point taxation scheme, which was there until 2004 and 5, so that would be a good move from a policy point of view. If they can resort to the old regime of taxation only at the time of sale of those shares.
All right. Okay. So I want to end by asking each of you the one thing that you think is most likely to be announced this time round on the personal taxation front. Pariza, let me start with you.
I just think, a little bit of tinkering again in the basic slab rates, in the basic amount chargeable to tax, maybe a little 50,000 upward again.
Right. Pallavi?
I would endorse that. My sense is also that they'll probably do something very simplistic and, something very simple, which could be the tinkering of the slab rates, and especially the minimum taxable slab rate.
And Kuldeep, what about you? What is the one thing that you believe FM will announce this time on the personal taxation front?
I will not materially differ from my, the other co-panelists. I mean, for example, the limit can go to 2,75,000, but those changes would be more of a token. The government need to focus on those taxpayers or those individuals who are not paying the tax, so that it is which will actually help to increase the collection.
All right. Thanks so much, Parizad, Pallavi and Kuldeep, for joining me on the show. We, of course, don't have a long wait before we actually find out what the finance minister announces in the Union Budget 2015. Time now for another quick break. We'll come back and recap what are the key expectations on the personal finance front from Budget 2015. Keep watching.